what time it is, y'all.
What time is it, Jacqueline?
It's time for Food
Co-ops
Now.
So what co-op are we featuring this week, Jacqueline?
I am excited to say we are featuring one from my home state of Illinois. We're featuring Green Top Grocery in Normal, Illinois. And Green Top opened their doors only 4 years ago. Their community did tons of work for 5 years to raise the money, to get the funds together, to open a beautiful 10,000 square foot grocery store. And now more than ever, their community is seeing how their co-op has changed the entire community for the better.
So what's going on? How have they been responding over the last month to meet their community need?
That's where their magic has really come to show and to shine at Green Top. So as you know, 3 weeks ago or so, whenever your state got the shelter-in-place order, there was a lot of panicking and people buying massive amounts of groceries and grocery store shelves just being stripped in the major chains.
I totally remember that. And people were kind of freaking out. Where do we get food, especially basic staples like eggs, milk, produce?
Right. Produce, absolutely. And it was especially the fresh stuff in a lot of cases that was the problem. Well, at Green Top, of course, this had already been happening. People were slowly buying more and more groceries as they were getting more nervous. And then the shelter-in-place order came down from our governor, and grocery stores are just stripped out. And Green Top saw it starting to happen, that they were running out of basics like potatoes, milk, eggs. They were getting low. But they got to do something that no grocery chain can do to solve the problem.
What do they do? How do they respond?
I think you know. They called what food co-ops do, what the food co-ops do. They call their local farmers. We talk about local food at food co-ops, but I think sometimes people take for granted what it really means that we work with local farms. So as they were running out of these items, they called one of their biggest local farms, which is Prairie Earth Farms in Atlanta, Illinois. And they said, we're running out of potatoes and carrots and greens. We're going to be out soon. And they said, say no more. They weren't expecting a delivery from that farm for several days. The farmers went out to their storage, got all the potatoes, carrots, pulled some greens for them, and were at the store within hours to restock the shelves and make sure they never ran out. Then, on top of that, if that wasn't cool enough, the same thing happened with Antiquity Farms, which is a farm that they work with to get them a lot of eggs. With their local dairy supplier, they caught a hold of them. All of these farms were at their store within hours with milk, eggs, potatoes, carrots, grains, basics that were out all over the community.
So how do the community members respond?
Well, luckily, people caught on to it because, of course, Green Top Grocery is one of the smaller grocery stores in its community, and there are a lot of chain grocery stores. But as people saw the chains unable to resupply, they started to hear the word that Green Top had all of these healthy foods and basics that they were so worried about finding on the shelves. People showed up in droves, and of course, Green Top did everything they could to keep everybody 6 feet apart and socially safe, but they had a tremendous response from the community.
That is amazing. And you know, you use the word chain. How does this connect to supply chain?
Well, that's the thing, right? I'd actually like to read a quote really quick from their general manager, Kristen Kramer, from Green Top Grocery, because she kind of speaks to this. And this was actually, she wrote this about 2 weeks ago. It's gotten worse since, but she said, you know, plenty of shipments right now are delayed because they're coming from overseas, from China, from various areas that where there's restrictions affecting the supply chain. But the news here is that your supply chain, you know, when it's just you, a phone, and a farmer who lives close by, you really can't disrupt that kind of supply chain. And so I think she's right. I think right now everyone's talking about supply chain, and we're going to see more ramifications in the months to come as the supply chain continues to unravel because it's been so consolidated. But that's not going to happen at local food co-ops because we have direct supply chains to farmers.
That's a really good point. And it also reminds me of the importance of people want to know. We want to know where our food is coming from. And when you can walk into your co-op and meet the farmer as they're dropping up their local produce, or talk to a knowledgeable co-op staff who's going to tell you about how that food was grown. And also thinking about where the money is going. I think about that visual of like, if I've got $50 in my pockets and I'm going into the grocery store, where is that money going? Is it being extracted, literally sucked out of our communities and given to corporate headquarters and God knows where? Or is it lining the pockets of local farmers and producers who are our neighbors and who are going to respond when you pick up the phone and say, hey, we need our... Can you get more eggs? Can you get more milk? And that's a huge difference. You know, we survey neighboring Food Co-op Association member food co-ops every year. And last year, on average, our food co-ops worked with over 250 local farmers and suppliers. That means that when you walk into the co-op, a good percentage of the products on the shelves are from within your region and probably from people that you know, right? So that means that your money is going directly to supporting a robust regional food system right around you. And in times like that, that's, you know, it's really important.
And didn't you say some of the food co-ops that even 45% of everything on the shelves is coming from local farms and producers?
A number of our members, that's almost half of the products that you see on the shelves are from local farmers and producers.
And just so y'all know, the statistic at large chain grocery stores is 1.8% of the food on those grocery store shelves on average are coming from local farmers and producers. So when the supply chain breaks down, they don't have that local chain of food to rely on. Food co-ops do. And not only do we have it to rely on, but we also can have the back of our farmers, because as much as we are happy can sell just about anything they can bring us right now, local farms are struggling right now and need that support. And you can pour that support and that money directly to those local farms and producers. That creates jobs on those farms. That creates jobs at your co-op. That keeps money in the local economy. And suddenly we're a lot more able to weather tough times together.
Exactly. And that's how we're seeing our food co-ops respond in this crisis, is they're weathering the storm. And like you said, with Green Top's example, they're bringing in shoppers that didn't know about them before, when they're noticing how they respond differently. And they're noticing the robust relationship that they have with local farmers and producers. And, you know, the co-op that we're going to be featuring next week.
You're going to give us a hint?
Mystery co-op here. But the story we're going to tell is about how the co-op has really innovated and responded in multiple ways over the last decade to address food insecurity in their community. So I'm excited to tell you that story.
Oh, I'm excited. And I think I have a sneaking suspicion who it might be. thank you guys for joining us for these great stories about what co-ops are doing. We have so many. We have like weeks planned out. So we'll be back next week to share more. This has been Jacqueline Hanna with Food Co-op Initiative. And my shout out this week is to Oshkosh Food Co-op, a startup food co-op in Oshkosh, Wisconsin, a community that's been working for several years to start their own food co-op. And now, since it's our business, we have to fund it. They just finished raising $1.6 million from their community as of this weekend and are ready to put spades in the ground to start their store. Congratulations!
Oshkosh, whoop whoop! Way to go, guys. The co-op I'm gonna shout out to is the Willimantic Food Co-op in Willimantic, Connecticut. They are turning 40 this year. They've been serving their community and accountable to their community for 40 years, and guess how they're celebrating?
How are they celebrating?
They bake a cake for every year that they've been in business, meeting the needs of their member owners. So this year, they're turning 40. That means 40 birthday cakes and a huge whopping party celebrating their community. So
wow. And did you tell me that, like, actually different members, different owners of the co-op bake cakes? So like 40 different owners bake a cake?
Their cakes are beautiful. You got to check out the photos. They probably have them on their Facebook page. But it's really, makes you joyful just thinking about eating that much cake and celebrating.
Yeah, right? Like, I could bake a cake, right? I don't bake, by the way. I'm not a good baker, but I have learned to bake since being stuck at home. So I'll bake one for you guys, Willimantic. Congratulations. Yay. On 40 years. All right, everyone. Well, this has been Jacqueline Hanna with Food Co-op Initiative.
And Bonnie Hesbeth with Neighboring Food Co-op Association.
And this has been
Food
Co-ops
Now.
Have a great week, everybody. Keep cooperating.
Bye, everyone.